Don Lothrop, and very good to see you again. Our last interview, I think, took place exactly 2 years ago, or 2 years and a half. It was in June 2012. Mm-hmm. At that time, I remember very well that you have counted your 58th visit in Romania, and still counting?
Still counting.
Still counting.
Yeah.
What number?
89.
89. That's a lot.
That's a lot, man. I missed you.
And that means you are very interested in this region. What is happening in Romania? What's going on? Yeah. What's gonna be?
I've always been interested. What I'm happy is that a lot more Americans are interested than were at visit 58.
What changed from last?
Russia invading Ukraine.
Russia and Ukraine.
In Ukraine.
That's but we don't feel it so much here in Romania, I would say.
Yeah, yeah.
I would say it's a problem of Ukraine. It's not our problem yet.
Yeah. Well, on July 4th, I actually saw Obama's speech on CNN. And in fact, just so I quote it right, you know, 70 years after in World War II when the Romanians switched to the Allied sides and we thought Americans were coming, an American president finally said it. He said, "Romanians, we stand together, now and forever, for your freedom is our freedom. Romania will never stand alone." And amidst all the chaos, you know, of an election, amidst the fact that it takes America a long time to move on things, that's a statement that possibly, you know, leads to a century, 100 years of peace and prosperity here, all the consequences of that.
And you are still optimistic, Don. Still optimistic as you were two years ago.
More.
But the circumstances wouldn't say that you have reason to be.
Well, first off, part of my optimism was always, in the end, the Russians would do something foolish. It would involve energy. And America would actually re-engage in this region, particularly re-engage in Romania and Poland. We're also re-engaging in the Baltics. But for all intents and purposes, America left Central and Eastern Europe in 2006. We left it to the European Union. And we had to do kind of our own, when I say we, I'm not involved in the American government, but I was at a couple of conferences where this was confirmed to me, is that we had to kind of do a gut check and say, you know what, democracy's failed in Iraq and Afghanistan. We waste trillions of dollars of there. What are we going to do now? And the intelligence is very clear, is that Russia is going to regain everything that they lost in 1989 until the Americans stop them.
Not only Ukraine.
Everything.
That implies probably Moldavia or
Romania, Lithuania, Estonia.
Baltic states.
Baltic, everything. And again, I'm not in the intelligence, but I was at the Center for European Policy and Analysis conference, and they're the leading think tank kind of policy setting agenda institution in Washington on October 2nd and 3rd across the board. And there were Germans there, there were Lithuanians there, there were French there. Everyone has concluded that they are going to take everything that they can get until the Americans stop them.
Some analysts are saying that it wouldn't be so easy for Russia to regain the influence over the lost space of influence of former USSR, because the economy is not going well, because after the sanctions, the ordinary people in Russia already feel the effects. And Mr. Putin has no power for in long term to support such a long and complex and expensive war to regain his influence over so many states. How do you comment on that?
Well, you know, a lot of people just take advantage of opportunities. I think Russia probably is in a lot of trouble in 10 years, you know, with their demographics, with dwindling energy supplies, dwindling technology. The Ukraine opened the door for him to take advantage of this while they had a chance. And, you know, because I don't think he's sure what he's going to do, but all the intelligence says he's going to take as much as he can get until the Americans say no. I had the pleasure, I spoke in your parliament 2 or 3 weeks ago, and I had a pleasure that afternoon of being invited to Washington to a joint session of the U.S. Congress to listen to and hear Ukrainian President Poroshenko. And he was very moved by the unity of 435 congressmen, 200 senators, bilaterally standing up applauding. And interesting, one of the realities in America is to be against Russia in Europe wins you votes. And so, you know, America has, in the case of Romania, we have decided we're coming, and that when we come, Obama makes some other points about democracy, you know, that ultimately Romania needs a civil society that holds its government leaders accountable. We don't have a democracy in Romania. Democracies, you know, one of the interesting things for me, Dan, is Orban and people here say Russia and China are the model. Russia and China are poorer than Romanians. The model is Taiwan and South Korea. Those are little countries where the people make, on average, $22,000 or $24,000 a year. In China, it's $6,000. And the reality, because it's ultimately about prosperity, and if the people in Taiwan are making four times what the people in China are making, that ought to be the model. And in those countries, their democracies are characterized by highly efficient bureaucracies. No long waits. They're characterized by great infrastructure that allows you to move. They're characterized by very trustworthy judicial systems. They're characterized by open political system where it's easy to form a new political party and get on the ground. They're characterized by a civil society that encourages thinking. They're characterized by great educational institutions. We don't have those in Romania yet, but that's, you know, that's the link between democracy and prosperity, and the Chinese and the Russians aren't doing it, and we haven't done it yet here.
You said on that the Russians won't stop until the Americans will say no,
right?
Stop. Tomorrow, we will have, on Friday, mm-hmm. actually, we will have here in Romania a historical event, actually. Mm-hmm. The Navy will commission, it was published on Star and Stripes, that the Navy will commission its new missile defense base in southern Romania on Friday, and is described being one of the two European land-based interceptor sites for a NATO missile shield vehemently opposed by Russia. The base represents a rare expansion of U.S. footprint in Europe, and a rare and an even rarer construction of a Navy base from the ground up. What does it mean for you, Don? Is this the answer? No?
Well, I think it's a huge part of the answer. Hmm. It's a huge part of the answer. First off, at the SEPA conference, James Townsend, who's one of the top people in the Department of Defense, which is military in America, heard a question. Obama gave strong words about your freedom is ours. We got you backed up. But they're marshmallow words, the questioner said. America's doing nothing. And this guy, James Townsend, you could see it in his eyes and his face. And then he went through division after division that's being deployed to Romania and Poland. And he goes, these are not marshmallow divisions. These are not marshmallow weapons. Now, he's not in the position where he wants to tell everybody what we're doing right here. He didn't mention this naval base. But you could see the fire in his eyes that even though we're not talking about everything that we're moving here, we're coming. We're going to back up these words in Romania.
But what's the importance of this event? It's a technical
the naval event?
Yeah.
I don't know what it is, Dan, but it's all part of what is going to be a major, major movement of American logistics, American missiles, American ships, American Air Force here in Romania. I mean, it's amazing. It's what we've been waiting for 70 years.
We have discussed on about the region a little bit, but I want to refer about what Mrs. Nuland just said last week. Mm-hmm. And I quote now, today I asked their leaders, she was referred to the leaders from Central Europe,
right,
saying that, how can you sleep under the NATO Article 5 blanket at mm-hmm. night while pushing illiberal democracy by day, whipping up nationalism, restricting free press, or demonizing civil society? I asked the same of those who shield corrupt officials from prosecution, mm-hmm. bypass parliament when convenient, or cut dirty deals that increase their country's dependence on the source of energy despite their stand policy of diversification. We thought Victoria Nuland was referring precisely to Viktor Orban and Viktor Ponta. What do you think? How do you read this?
Well, Victoria spoke at the SEPA conference, and she referred to democratic backsliding and corruption across Central Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It was very clear. She didn't say Hungary, across Central Europe.
Right.
You know, things like a country that has a referendum, spends 20 million euros on a referendum in 1909 of the taxpayers' money to say, do you want to shrink the parliament to less than 300 people in this country? The people vote by an 88% majority and the parliament ignores it. That's not a democracy. You know, a law on defense, and these are the things that are becoming obvious to America now that we're committing ourselves to this country. We can go down list by list by list. In this election right here, there's many reporters that are being silenced during the election. We now know that we're paying attention to it. This reforestation law, one of the people of the Romania asked their representatives, the government, to cut the age of the trees for deforestation, allow you to clear cut more, and cut down to riverbanks so we can have more floods. These kind of policies don't come from the interests of the people. It's not a democracy. It's a pre-democracy. And Victoria's comment is, we've done this in Iraq and Afghanistan. We've tried to impose something on a country that didn't embrace it and didn't want it. And we're not going to fight for a system that represses people.
Well, when you heard Victoria's words, Dan.
Yeah. First thing I thought was Romania. I don't live in Hungary. It's the first thing I thought was here. Because we still live in a government that doesn't lift people up. People have to, in order to form a company here, it's a lot easier to go to London to stay in your country to form one because of bureaucracy. We don't have a system that builds roads so people can easily do commerce. We don't have a system here that lifts people up. It puts them down. Those were Obama's words. We need governments that lift people up. They don't hold them down.
So you recognize Romania in Victoria Nuland's criticism?
It's screaming, Romania. Now, I'm so much more optimistic about Romania, and I actually, the thing that's different for me about Romania, and this is just personal, is I think the leader of Hungary, from what I read, has a very clear vision for where he wants to go, and it's not good.
Orban openly say that Putin is the model, Russia
right,
is
right,
the model.
Right, exactly. And not a whole bunch of reasons, you can't, restriction of press, restriction of internet, the people are poor there. I mean, Orban ought to say Taiwan and South Korea are the model, he wants prosperity. So Romania, we don't have that, but we still have a huge lack of ideas. We have a lack of vision, we have a lack of principle for what we want this country to be. What we have in Romania, and this is the way I'm optimistic, is that we have incredible people. You know, I've had a couple generals in the United States military, when they heard about Romania One, call me, American generals, and say, anything I can do to help. Romanians are the most trustworthy soldiers we've ever dealt with. We've got American IT companies that employ more people in Romania than anywhere in Europe, because Romanians are the most creative problem solvers. And we've got business executives, university professors who come over here and say, Romanians are the best learners. They just ask questions. They're a sponge to learn. That's who we are. We're trustworthy, we're creative problem solvers, and we're learners.
The question is, Dan, the question is, how can Romania resist in the region, saying that Hungary seems to be under Putin influence, mm-hmm. totally.
Mm-hmm.
Decision-making in Bulgaria is highly controlled by Moscow,
right,
at least
right.
look to be.
Yeah, yeah.
And the question is, how can we resist in this area?
Well, so we already talked about America. America's influence here is going to be very large, because where we put a lot of military, we're going to put a lot of reporters, and we're going to have a country where the light switches are going on. And remember what I said, Dan, despite what we wanted to believe, America left the region in 2006, just handed it to the EU. We're coming back. And so that's one part. The second part, which is absolutely as important, and President Obama said that democracy is not elections. You know, it is civil society. And that what I see in 20-year-olds, I mean, the culture in this country is changing. 20-year-olds are very eager to volunteer and get involved. And this is why I formed Romania One, is people need to understand, first off, what a democracy is. It is a group of citizens, we call it civil society, who knows the law. And they assume the responsibility to come up to solutions with problems and hold the government accountable. That's what people do in a democracy. We don't have a culture of that yet here in Romania. Most Romanians don't know the law. Many of the police and the politicians don't. But we have to learn the law. And then we have to understand that in a democracy, politicians raise money, they shake hands, they give speeches, and they negotiate. They don't solve problems. In my country, they don't. All the solutions for problems in America come from civil society. And that's what we need to build. And while I don't see a civil society of 40-year-olds in this country or 50-year-olds, I see civil society happening right now among 30 and 20-year-olds.
I think you are a little bit involved in this kind of projects. I saw you being deeply involved in some events in Romania. For example, I saw you at SIPA conference 2 or 3 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And I'm watching your activity in Romania One.
Yeah.
Will you tell us a little bit more about the Romania One project?
Romania One is taking what Romanians are already doing in terms of civil society and making it stronger. When I founded it a year ago, I took 10 Romanians out to Hollywood and San Francisco to talk about how you change culture, because politics reflects culture. Our culture says, I don't care, I don't want to come up with solutions, our politicians will. And what we concluded is, out of that, I went and did town meetings across Romania with hundreds and hundreds, probably thousands of Romanians. And I saw many people doing things as a civil society. But they did it by themselves. They did it without really knowing the law. So if there was an illegal building or a problem, they would go by themselves without knowing the law to somebody in the government. And so there's an instinct to act now. Particularly among mothers, because they say, you know, you did it to my parents, you did it to me, you're not doing it to my kids. What we're going to do is say that instinct is good, but we're going to make it better. Romania One is going to develop an application with a series of modules that tells you the law, that forces you to form a group, because in civil society you work in groups. It forces you to write down a thoughtful idea, not a criticism or complaint, and it allows you to make it public. You never win in this country if you go by yourself in a closed door and ask the government official to do something. You usually win if you know the law, you go in a group, you have a thoughtful idea, and you make it public. And so Romania One, if you go to the website, we just relaunched it Monday, RomaniaOne.org. We describe what Romania One is. Our first module are stories, where we're going to be telling the stories of groups of citizens with a thoughtful idea, without a criticism or complaint, engaging in the struggle and success of their town. And a lot of them begins on the street. When I spoke on Monday at Babeș Bolyai, I used the quote, it's a great quote for Romanian, from American President Teddy Roosevelt, who after his presidency, he went to a university. He went to the Sorbonne, to the French people, the young French kids, who were trying to figure out how they created a real republic where the power rested in the people. And he gave his classic speech, "The credit goes to the person who's in the Rita, who's actually doing something, for whom at best, if they succeed, they know the thrill of high achievement. If at worst they fail, at least they're not among the cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat." And what I'm telling Romanians, you are not cold and timid souls. You're passionate, resilient people. Get up, get involved. And I'm absolutely confident the 20-year-olds in this country are going to do it.
Hope they do. Hope they will.
They will. The 20-year-olds will. They're doing it.
Last question, it's about campaign and about
of course.
Elections.
Yeah.
The electoral campaign, as you may know, started a couple of days ago, on November the 2nd, mm-hmm. Romania will elect the new president. Mm-hmm. By the way, do you have an option? If you are not a Romanian citizenship, you don't vote here, but do you have an option?
I have a very clear point of view. Let me go back to my website, RomaniaOne.org. I have on there the story, Parable of the Horseshoe, which was taught to me by a German, that talks about these 8 ideas of freedom, of prosperous freedom. And then we're doing, actually there's 11 ideas, we call them oak trees. We have 3 of them on the website now. One is balance of power. I mean, it's very fundamental in our country where we have checks and balances against corruption in one institution or the other. So in Washington, we have the president, the Congress, and the judiciary. And then we have at the local level, where most schools and police are run locally, Washington can't touch them. So it is fundamentally essential in this country that we have independent institutions that hold each other accountable. Therefore, I don't think Romania should ever have a president who's in the same political party that controls parliament. I don't think it was good during the PDL years when they controlled both. And I think it would be horrible if we continued to have a president who is in the same political party Yeah, because that's that you've lost the check and balance. As I understand the presidency in this country, they appoint a number of important judges to anti-corruption tribunals. They appoint people in the DNA. And I look at the president of this country, if I look at his job responsibilities, most Romanians, if you go to a Romanian high school class and say, what's your president do? Most Romanians don't know. As I understand what he does, he is the top policeman against corruption in the parliament.
Thank
Therefore,
you
I would vote, I'd vote for somebody who would do that job the best.
Thank you very much, Don. Thanks a lot.